Men with advanced prostate cancer. Mm-hmm. 30,000 men each year die from that disease. And a very, very innovative drug, Provenj, was taking forever going through clinical trials. And it eventually, the FDA advisory panel voted 17-0 that it was safe. And clearly they also, the majority said it was, the efficacy was, mm-hmm. was fine. The FDA went back to the biotech company and said, you have to do another clinical trial. That took 3 years. Meanwhile, 30,000 men every year are dying without the freedom of choice to use Provenj. Free to choose medicine is a bold, common sense reform which enables patients, advised by their doctors, to have access to not yet FDA-approved drugs, drugs that have passed the FDA safety trials and are in late-stage clinical development. A friend of mine, Frank Burroughs, lost his daughter, Abigail, to cancer. And she was not able to have access to a developmental drug, Erbitux, which her doctor thought might have been able to save her life. Although Erbitux was later approved, it was too late for Abigail. And Frank then, after that, formed the Abigail Alliance for faster access to developmental drugs. And that tries to help patients literally to save their life to access these drugs and fight the FDA. Now in my book, you know, Frank is a hero. Mm-hmm. But we don't need more heroes like Frank. What we need is free to choose medicine. And in a world of free to choose medicine, patients like Abigail would have access to developmental drugs up to 5 years before they might be approved by the FDA. We should think of the entire drugs to patients system. And right now we have the FDA, which has dealing with one component of that system, clinical testing. Mm-hmm. And they do that to such an extreme that they're degrading the overall goal of the system. And it's very important that we focus on the appropriate goal for the system. And that is better drugs sooner at lower cost. And the FDA has shunted aside sooner at lower cost. With free to choose medicine, consumer choice and competition are put on the table. And competition would compel the FDA to innovate, much like how the post office was compelled to bring one-day express mail service due to the competition from FedEx. Mm-hmm. Here's how it would work. With free-to-choose medicine, the key idea is a dual-track system. And on one track, drug developers continue with the conventional clinical testing and FDA approval process. On a separate free-to-choose track, independent of the FDA, drug developers that have a drug that has passed safety trials and is generating late-stage clinical data could elect to sell that drug to patients and doctors. The key idea is making an informed decision. So as part of this dual track system, there would be a trade-off evaluation database that would, mm-hmm. on the internet, so that patients and doctors could evaluate both approved drugs and not yet approved drugs. But the FDA thinks that we're not smart enough to use a trade-off evaluation database, mm-hmm. and have all this up-to-date information comparing approved drugs to drugs in late-stage clinical trials. And the idea that we're not smart enough is absolutely untrue. The Abigail Alliance has fought for 17 drugs in late-stage clinical trials, and all 17 were approved. That's 17 out of 17. Mm-hmm. So the idea that we're not smart enough to separate out and pinpoint drugs that are extraordinarily promising is mm-hmm. simply false. The FDA will never reform itself. The primary goal of the FDA is to avoid negative publicity from adverse side effects from approved drugs. Consequently, this extreme tunnel vision focus on safety causes people to suffer and die needlessly. Now, the nightly news, for example, never tells us that the FDA is a real bottleneck in the system, and that bottleneck results in an invisible graveyard of those who were, are, and will be denied access. Free to Choose Medicine will build upon the hugely successful program of off-label drug use. Off-label drug use is when doctors with intimate knowledge of their patients' health conditions and needs, they prescribe an approved drug for use that it was not approved. And off-label drug use is extraordinarily successful. And that same idea is carried forward by Free to Choose Medicine. I'll give you an example. Mm-hmm. A while back, Tysabri, which is a drug to treat MS, was pulled off the market because of adverse side effects. They were quite rare, but they were deadly when they occurred. Mm-hmm. And here again, we have the unavoidable trade-off decision. It's your current health situation and the benefits from taking a drug, but the risk of adverse side effects. And when that drug was pulled, MS patients literally took to the street, demanding that the FDA give them the right to make that trade-off decision. Mm-hmm. And eventually the FDA relented. Now with Free to Choose Medicine, we have a dynamic system that automatically gives people consumer choice on the issue. The most compelling argument for Free to Choose Medicine, one that cuts across all political affiliations, is that individuals and their families ought to be free to improve or save a life, even if doing so incurs some risk. And a Free to Choose Medicine Act would enable a fundamental right to take control of medical decision making to be given to people. And as a practical matter, once that right was secured, it could never be taken away. So it's time, it's really time to take back control of medical decision making, and it's time for Congress to pass and the President to sign a Free to Choose Medicine Act.